Battle for America is on. Your spiritual warfare training center, GodsWar2020.com.
Dr. Jerry is on the attack, liberty's friend and tyranny's foe. The heathen are raging and the battle for America is on. The devil beware, Dr. Scheidbach is on the air, deftly swinging the sword of the spirit, aimed at the heart of the dragon of lies, the prince of the power of the air.
Welcome to God's War Headquarters, your spiritual warfare training center.
Hello, I'm Dr. Scheidbach. It's God's War, and the battle for America is on.
Truth served here, flavored with delectable wit, succulent sagacity, luscious logic, a gourmet meal for the mind.
Welcome to your spiritual warfare headquarters in God's War, the battle for America. I'm Dr. Scheidbach, pastor, conference speaker, professor at large, host of the Brain Massage Radio Show, executive editor of Dr. Beckham's magazine, The Intercessor, author of God's War, Why Christians Should Rule the World, and Kingdom Power by Prayer and Fasting, among other titles, and your host on God's War, The Battle for America. My show addresses current events from a biblical perspective and offers support for fellow warriors who are engaged in spiritual warfare, wrestling against principalities and powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So let's get started. We are at war. It's God's war. And for us, ground zero is the battle for America. The contest is whether America will continue as one nation under God or be dragged to the maw of hell to be cast off with all nations that forget God. Our weapons are not carnal, but they are mighty. And we have been given armor to wear in our battle, the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, gospel shoes, a helmet, a shield, and a sword. And all these things we will examine together closely. But, my friend, many Christians today, it seems to me, are loosening the belt of truth to give room to bellies bloated by gorging their carnal appetites. They seem to be looking for the hammock and not the helmet, the breast of another man's wife and not the breastplate of righteousness. They want to wear their dancing shoes, not the gospel shoes. They want to swing, but not the sword of the Spirit. They think to cover all of this under a false shield of faith, one of their own making, constructed out of scriptures, wrested into a cloak of covetousness. Ignoring the rebuke of the Spirit through Jude, they turn the precious grace of God into lasciviousness. Their affections are set fully upon sensuality. So they've lost their sense. They've dulled their senses to the Spirit. Such Christians, if active at all in recruiting souls to Christ, are salesmen pitching a product carefully packaged to appeal to the gospel consumers. These are not soldiers declaring the terms of surrender commanded by Christ, and that is the command that all men everywhere repent, confess Jesus is Lord, and believe on Jesus Christ for salvation from the wrath to come. We are at war. God has called us to be soldiers, not salesmen. Satan has got most of the world under his power, and so Christians are the most persecuted people on the planet today, and tyrants increasingly oppress us. America is the last hope freedom has in the earth today. So Satan is trying to destroy her. The spirit of Antichrist and the spirit of Jesus Christ are at war over America. Like in the days of Daniel, when the angelic prince of Persia fought against God's mighty angels Gabriel and Michael, in order to control the kingdom of men. Well, today, Satan wars to control America, and he has been winning, it would seem, but no longer. This spiritual war is played out in the physical world between the children of obedience on the one side and the children of disobedience on the other. The children of obedience have obeyed the gospel. The children of disobedience refuse to yield to Jesus Christ as Lord and King. The sides are polarized. Those who hate Christ rail against him openly and say, as much as, we will not have that man to reign over us. They openly call for the murder of babies up to term and even after they are born. Rulers among them openly mock Christianity. Schumer and AOC have lately referred to those of us who believe the Bible as believing fairy tales. Remember, Hillary scolded us that we'll have to give up on our Bible-based beliefs. Obama said America is no longer a Christian nation and spoke dismissively of those he regards as Bible and gun clingers. Feinstein challenged Kavanaugh's fitness to serve on the Supreme Court because of his Christian beliefs. The Democrat Party voted against including an acknowledgement of God in their party platform. Unheard of. They routinely show their disdain for public expressions of faith, and effectively they cry, "Let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us," exactly as the psalmist prophesied what happened some 1,000 years before Christ. And the children of disobedience rage. "We will not have Christianity imposed on us." But they take every opportunity to impose on us their ungodly values. They will force us to support abortion through our taxes. They force us to endorse the deathly lifestyle of sodomy, today called homosexuality. They force upon our children the ridiculous and unnatural notion of gender fluidity, encouraging young boys to think themselves girls and so on, all contrary to nature and, of course, to nature's God. All of it rooted in their religion, their religious views, the religion of atheism or secularism or pragmatism or any variety of pantheism. The same who cry against any imposition of Christian morality upon them eagerly turn to impose their immorality on us every time we step back to accommodate their free will to choose against Christ and to behave ungodly and wickedly in this world. They quickly take what place we vacate and set up a stronghold from which they begin assaulting our liberties, our freedoms, our faith, our families, our values. No wonder we were warned in Scripture, "Give no place to evil or to the devil." Away with this creeping encroachment upon our God-given inalienable rights. This nation was founded by Christians and upon Christian values and beliefs, as our founders repeatedly affirmed. If they want to live under communism, let them go to China. But don't let them turn America into China. Let them go to Venezuela. But don't turn America into Venezuela. We who love God are willing to yield to the biblical principle of freedom of religion, of free speech, of conscience, and free will for all. And so we must insist upon the same. A message to all children of hell. You might live out your wicked lives rejecting God and hating Christ, and we will grieve for you and even pray for you. But the minute you start encroaching upon our divinely given inalienable rights, well, you've crossed the line, and you will find out that God's sheep roar. Read Revelation 5 more carefully than perhaps you have. The spirit of Antichrist hates Christ, hates Jesus, hates the restraints of God's law against evil, chafes against the bands of righteousness and the cords of restraint. The Antichrist spirit cries in and through Saul Alinsky's disciples, "Let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us." It cries in them and through them, "We will not have that man, Jesus, to reign over us." It's irrational. It's unreasonable. They're obsessed, blind in their rage, driven by their father, the father of lies, the devil himself. I've had considerable personal experience with this. Here's one story of many. In my early days of broadcasting, unbelievers would rail against me, saying I had no right to mention Jesus on public airwaves. I had no right to quote the Bible on the radio, they would say. I have broadcasts on secular stations, you see. And in the beginning, I was repeatedly told, "You can't say those things on public radio waves. You can't mention Jesus or quote the Bible." The station manager one day called me aside and advised me to tone down the God talk, as he called it. He said, "Pastor, you're a very smart man. You can find a way to make your point without mentioning Jesus or quoting directly from the Bible." I asked this dear friend, and he had become a friend by then, I asked him to let me take care of it. I went to the radio the next airing, and I used to do my show live, so I got all settled in. They flipped the switch, and I began. "I understand some of you are troubled by my use of, well, let's just say the name of a certain religious leader, and you don't like it when I quote from a certain religious book. Well, I would like to conduct a test. Please find your pulse." Yeah, two fingers on your wrist just below your palm. There you go. Got it? Good. "Now, I'm going to mention the name of some religious leaders, and you tell me if your heart rate increases. Are you ready? Buddha. Nothing? How about Muhammad?" Now, this was before 9/11, so nothing. "How about Krishna? Nothing? Confucius? Joseph Smith? Nothing? Interesting. Okay. How about Jesus?" Yikes! Heart rate spiking all over the city. "Hey, lady, good night. You're hyperventilating. Grab a bag. Breathe into it slowly. There you go. Calm down. Oh, no, over there. That guy's having a heart attack. Someone call 911. And you, good night. You're trembling so violently. I'm afraid you're going to break your foot. No, don't slam the phone so hard. Look, I'm not responsible for any broken equipment out there. Okay?" And then I chuckled and paused. And I asked, "Why do you suppose that name bothers you?" "I'll tell you why. But to do so, I'm going to have to quote from a certain book. a book our founders used and referenced more than any other single book, the book our presidents have laid their hand upon to swear an oath to defend the Constitution, which, if you remember, recognizes our right to free speech, by the way, the book that served as the basis of our laws and shaped our culture, that one, you know. But today, some Americans seem to think it's against the law to quote it on public radio. What? So let me give you a warning. Bible thump alert. Bible thump alert. The reason you irrationally react with so much intensity against that particular name is because that is, in fact, the only name given among men whereby you must be saved. And the devil hates it. It's the name that will be exalted above every name. It's the name whereby the simplest Christian can make the devil flee. And anyway, I went on like that for a few weeks, and it all went away, by the way. Yeah, some called in actually to apologize for making a fuss about it. They were embarrassed. Today, I boldly declare the name of Jesus and quote from the Bible on secular and on Christian radio. I regained territory in my own little corner of America that so many before me had given up. Okay, this show was kind of an introduction. I'll be back tomorrow at this time and the same station to carry on our study of spiritual warfare. And we will be using my books, Kingdom Power by Prayer and Fasting and God's War, Why Christians Should Rule the World. Some Christians react negatively to that title, I find. They seem to be afraid how the world will react to it. You know, it's kind of unfunny to me. If an atheist said atheists should rule the world, it would hardly produce a blip on anyone's radar. Atheistic communists have been saying it for decades. If someone said secularists should rule the world, well, no one would bat an eye. If secularists believe religion has no place in government. And yet, funny enough, secularist values are shaped by some or another form of religious belief, even if it is the belief that God has no say in politics, which is, of course, absurd. And, of course, no one finds it surprising that a Muslim would say that Muslims or Islam should rule the world. But if a Christian says Christians should rule the world, everybody freaks out. Why is that? Everywhere Christianity is the prevailing influence in culture and politics, liberty prevails. Wherever Christianity is oppressed, tyranny prevails. Just look at a map of the world and you'll see that wherever Christianity is oppressed or suppressed, you find varying levels of tyranny prevail. Why is that? The Bible says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. If you know anything about the Antichrist, you know he is against Christ, Antichrist, against the saints of God, Christians. He is a tyrant. Well, the spirit of Antichrist is in the world today, according to the Bible. And wherever you find it, you find tyranny. In fact, liberty or tyranny is directly relative to how much influence Christianity has in a culture. The gospel proclaims liberty and truth sets you free spiritually and physically. On this show, you're going to learn how to engage in spiritual warfare against the spirit of Antichrist in our battle for America. And the two textbooks for this course are Kingdom Power by Prayer and Fasting. It's a book about prayer and fasting from a biblical perspective. You'll really enjoy it. It's a very short read. And God's War, Why Christians Should Rule the World. That's a hardback, over 500 pages, thorough indices, appendices, written in easy-to-read print. I mean, you'll love this book. You can purchase these at www.godswar2020.com. That's www.godswar2020.com. It's God's war. We are His soldiers. And our battle is the battle for America. And I'll see you at the same time, same station tomorrow. God bless you. God bless America. And I'll see you in church.
God's War. Why Christians Should Rule the World. A shocking statement to many, but our founders didn't think so. John Jay believed Christians should prefer believers to rule our nation. Because Jesus is the King, and all mankind are subject to His crown. Our founding fathers understood this and acknowledged Christ as King. Satan once boasted all the kingdoms of the world were his, but no longer. Because when Jesus died on the cross, he broke the power of Satan over this world and cast the prince of this world out. When Jesus rose from the grave, he declared, "All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth." Jesus sent his spirit into the world, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But where the spirit of Antichrist is, there is tyranny. The spirit of Jesus Christ is greater than the spirit of Antichrist. Now, you can learn how to unleash the power of Christ into the world to defeat the spirit of Antichrist. Learn how you can defend liberty through the authority of Jesus Christ. Get God's War, Why Christians Should Rule the World, today. Go to God's War. The Battle for America is on. Your spiritual warfare training center. God's War, 2020.com.